почиваю.
Помсти, благодарний Христе, служби родичеш свій
Thank you.
сестрам, замученим голодом 32-33 років. Сьогодні ми пам'ять про них молитви творимо за їхні душі. Господи, прийми наші молитви, сотвори вічною пам'ять.
It was a famine which even today is relative to Rome, and still has to fight for its rightful place in the 20th century history. In the 20s and early 30s, Ukrainians were seen by Stalin's government as a threat to the Soviet Union because of their continuing aspirations for independence in defense of their language, history, and culture. Stalin embarked on a relentless campaign to destroy the Ukrainian problem. Thousands of Ukrainian intellectuals, clergy, community leaders were imprisoned, exiled, or simply murdered. The next victims were small farms and villages who owned their own small plots of land in order to feed their families. During the early part of the 1930s, the Soviet Union began to force farmers into collective farms. Brigades swept into villages and took away livestock, grain, and every last vestige of food. The more prosperous farmers were turned out of their houses. By the autumn of 1932, the impossibly harsh grain quotas meant there was no food at all. People began to die in their millions. Between autumn 32 and spring 33, around 25,000 people died each day. And the total death toll was larger than that of the whole of the population of Wales. Desperate pleas for help were ignored, the quarters were tightened, and death records were falsified to remove all mention of death by starvation. At the same time, the Soviet Union continued to export grain to Western countries. Today, we recognise the Holodomor for what it truly was, a genocide against the Ukrainian people, carried out to destroy a nation which simply wanted to live a peaceful and independent life. In spite of this, however, the dream of independence did not die. It was stronger than any state-sponsored violence, terror, and repression. And the facts are no longer hidden, with documents and thousands of eyewitnesses accounts telling the truth about one of the greatest atrocities of the 20th century. In remembering the millions of innocent lives of Holodomor, we today give them the compassion and dignity that they deserve. And we also shine the light of historical justice, and with the abiding hope that nowhere can such an atrocity ever be allowed to happen again. Eternal memory to the victims of the Holodomor. Вічна і славна пам'ять невинним жертвам.
Receive something to died, leaving only my mother and me. My mother went to work on the hothouse and would leave me on my own all day. At least she returned home at the end of every day with a cupful of food. I was so young to have had to live through all this. We both survived. Eventually, when the famine had ended, with the help of my mother's sister, we were able to grow crops. But it was so hard to get used to there just being the two of us out of a family of six.
This is a short extract of survivor testament of Reverend Mikhail Khudobin, who was born on the 24th of April 1924 in Kryvyi Rih, Ukraine. He settled in Bradford, West Yorkshire, where he served as the parish priest of the Bradford Ukrainian Orthodox Church. He died on 5 May 2013. During the famine, my parents left the village. There was nothing left for us to exchange for food. I remember my father laid out in the house. He did not survive this terrible atrocity and died on 17 June 1932. My mother was pregnant at the time, and 3 days after my father's death, my sister Helena was born. My mother went to work down the iron ore mines because the workers there were given a small daily ration of bread. She worked there for 5 years. My mother's father, my grandfather, lived 3 kilometres from us and worked as a bread delivery man. The bread was not packaged in those days, so he would collect morsels of bread and bring them for us. We would use these morsels to make soup together with weeds in order to survive. But this was very bland, as there was no salt available.
This is an extract from the survivor testaments of Claudia Sinyali, who was born on the 6th of September 1925 in Petrovsky village in the Kharkiv region of Ukraine. She settled in Farsley, where she still lives, and was featured on the Look North programme last night. She says, "When my sister was dying, she said to me, 'Claudia, give me some milk. Mama, please give me something to eat.' But there was nothing to do. We walked around like skeletons. Our bodies were glowing, and we looked as though we'd been plumped up. That is how it was. That is how we were. It was terrible, truly, truly terrible. No one paid any attention to anything. No one paid any attention at all. On the streets, in the villages, people, usually children, just sat there. One here, dead. One there, dead. Dogs walked by, sniffed, and even they didn't want to go near me. It was a terrible, terrible time for me, one that I will never forget. I do not know how I and my mother survived."